Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of Old City Hall by Robert Rotenberg, narrated by Paul Hecht and directed by Danny Snelson. This book is copyrighted 2009 by Robert Rotenberg. This recording is copyrighted 2009 by Recorded Books. The author opens with a quote from Suzanne by Leonard Cohen. And she shows you where to look among the garbage and the flowers. There are heroes in the seaweed. There are children in the morning. They are leaning out for love, and they will lean that way forever. And now, Old City Hall.
Chapter 1. Much to the shock of his family, Mr. Singh rather enjoyed delivering newspapers. Who would have thought that Gurdial Singh, former chief engineer for Indian Railways, the largest transportation company in the world, would be dropping newspapers at people's doors commencing at 5:05 each morning? He didn't need to work, but since coming to Toronto 4 years earlier, he had absolutely insisted on it. No matter that he was turning 74 years old on Thursday next. Yes, it was a silly little job, Mr. Singh was forced to concede to his wife Bimal and their three daughters, but he liked it. That's why Mr. Singh was humming an old Hindi tune to himself as he walked briskly through the early winter darkness on a cold Monday morning, the 17th of December. He entered the marble-appointed lobby of the Marketplace Tower, a luxury condominium on Front Street, and gave a friendly wave to Mr. Rashid, the night concierge. The Globe and Mail newspapers were neatly stacked just inside the door, beside a diminutive plastic Christmas tree. How strange, in a country covered in forests, that they would use plastic trees, Mr. Singh thought, as he hitched up his grey flannel pants and bent down to cut the binding cord with his pocket knife. He sorted the papers into 12 piles, one for each floor on his route. It had been easy to memorize which residents took a paper, and it was a simple matter to walk down the deserted hallways and drop one squarely at each door. The solitude was very nice, so unlike the clutter of Delhi. When he arrived at the top floor, Mr. Singh knew he would see the one person who was always awake, Mr. Kevin something. Mr. Singh could never remember Mr. Kevin's last name, even though the gentleman was one of the most famous people in Canada. There he would be, in his shabby bathrobe, a cigarette cupped in his right hand, a mug of tea in his left, scratching his grey beard with his shoulder, anxiously awaiting his morning paper. Mr. Kevin was the host of a morning radio show that was broadcast across the country. Mr. Singh had tried to listen to it a few times, but it was just a lot of chatter about fishing in Newfoundland, fiddle music in the Ottawa Valley, and farming on the prairies. These Canadians were funny people. Most of them lived in cities, but all they seemed to discuss was the countryside. Mr. Kevin, despite his unkempt appearance, was very much a gentleman. Rather shy, Mr. Singh enjoyed the ritual conversation they had each morning. "Good morning, Mr. Singh," Mr. Kevin always said. "Good morning, Mr. Kevin," Mr. Singh always said in reply. "And how is your beautiful wife?" "More beautiful than ever, Mr. Singh," Mr. Kevin would say. Putting the cigarette in his mouth, he'd open his palm and pass an orange slice over to Mr. Singh. "Thank you," Mr. Singh would say, giving Mr. Kevin his newspaper. "Freshly sliced," Mr. Kevin would answer. They'd then follow up with a short discussion about gardening or cooking or tea. Despite all he must have had on his mind, Mr. Kevin never seemed rushed. It was simply courteous and respectful conversation at an ungodly hour. Quite civilized. It took the usual 25 minutes for Mr. Singh to methodically work his way up to the 12th floor. There were only 2 suites on the top floor. Mr. Kevin's suite, 12A, was to the left, around the bend, near the end of a long corridor. The resident to the right, an older lady who lived alone, took the other paper, which he always delivered last. Mr. Singh arrived at Mr. Kevin's door, and as usual, it was halfway open. But there was no sign of Mr. Kevin. I could just leave the newspaper here, Mr. Singh thought. Then he'd miss their daily conversation. He waited for a moment. Of course, he could not knock, that would be highly improper. Humming louder, he shuffled his feet, hoping to make enough noise to announce his arrival. Still no one came. He hesitated. It was the engineer in him. He liked routine, order. He remembered the day his 11th form mathematics teacher taught the class that there was no such thing as parallel lines, that because the earth was round, any two parallel lines would eventually meet. Mr. Singh didn't sleep for a week. There was a noise from inside the apartment, an odd, hollow sound. That was strange. Then a door closed. Good, he thought, as he waited. But there was silence again. Maybe he should leave. Instead, he took Mr. Kevin's newspaper and dropped it onto the parquet floor just outside the door. It landed with a loud smack, which he hoped would signal his presence in the doorway. He'd never done anything like this before. There was another noise inside, distant. Were they footsteps? What should he do? He certainly could not enter. Mr. Singh waited. For the first time, he looked down at the front page of the newspaper. There was a picture of an ice hockey player raising his arms in the air and a story about the local team, the Toronto Maple Leafs. How odd that the name was misspelled, Leafs and not Leaves, and the color of the leaf on the jersey was blue. Mr. Singh had seen lovely red and yellow maple leaves, but never a blue one. At last, he heard footsteps approaching the door. Mr. Kevin came into the hallway wearing his usual bathrobe and opened the door all the way. Mr. Singh heard a soft tap as it rested on the door stopper. But where was his cigarette, his tea? Mr. Kevin was looking at his hands, rubbing his fingers. Mr. Singh noticed something red on his fingertips. He had a pleasant thought. Blood oranges. He so loved to eat them back home, and he'd recently found that they arrived in Canadian stores this time of year. Had Mr. Kevin been cutting one? Mr. Kevin raised his hands to the light. Mr. Singh could see the red liquid clearly now. It was thick and heavy, not thin, like juice from an orange. Mr. Singh's heart began to race. It was blood. Mr. Singh opened his mouth to speak, but before he could say a word, Mr. Kevin leaned closer. "I killed her, Mr. Singh," he whispered. "I killed her." Chapter 2. Officer Daniel Kennicott was running flat out. "Where do you want me to go?" he called back to his partner, Nora Baring, who was half a step behind him. "I'll cover the lobby," she said as they rushed into the marketplace tower. "You go up." A uniformed man, standing behind a long wooden desk, looked up from his newspaper as they hurried past. Inside, the marble walls were covered with textured sculptures, bouquets of fresh flowers seemed to be everywhere, and classical music was playing softly. As the senior officer, it was Baring's job to assign tasks in urgent situations. As they were running, she'd called the dispatcher directly on her cell phone to avoid the scanners who picked up police calls. The key facts were that at 5:31, 12 minutes ago, Kevin Brace, the famous radio host, met his newspaper delivery man, a Mr. Singh, at the door of his penthouse, Suite 12A. Brace said that he'd killed his wife. Singh found a body, adult female, apparently deceased, in the bathtub. He reported that the body was cold to the touch, and Brace was unarmed, calm. That the suspect was calm, almost placid, was common in domestic homicides, Kennicott thought. The passion of the moment had dissipated. Shock was setting in. Baring pointed to the stairway door beside the elevator. Two choices, stairs or elevator, she said. Kennicott nodded and took a deep breath. If you take the elevator, Baring said, procedure is to get off two floors below. Kennicott nodded again. He'd learned this in basic training when he joined the force. A few years before that, two officers had answered what sounded like a routine domestic call on the 24th floor of a suburban apartment building. When the elevator door opened, they were gunned down by the father who'd already killed his wife and only child. I'll take the stairs, he said. Remember, every word the suspect says is vital, Baring said, as Kennicott gulped in more air. Be 100% accurate with your notes. Right. Enter with your gun out, she said, but be careful with it. Kennicott nodded. Okay. Radio me just before you get to the top floor. Got it, Kennicott said, as he plunged into the stairwell. The job of the first officer on scene at a homicide was containment. It was like trying to protect a sandcastle in a windstorm, because every second bits of evidence were blowing away. He was tempted to take the stairs, three at a time, but between his bulletproof vest, his gun, and the portable hand radio, he was carrying about 8 pounds of equipment. Just be steady, he told himself. By the time he got to the third floor, taking two steps at a time, he was in a smooth rhythm. Kennicott and Baring had been on shift 4 nights in a row and were just an hour away from going home for 4 days' rest when this hotshot emergency call came in. They'd been across the street strolling through the St. Lawrence Market, the city's big indoor food emporium, which was setting up for the day. When he hit the sixth floor, a small drop of perspiration formed at the base of Kennicott's neck and began to work its way down his backbone. Up until this call, it had been a pretty quiet night. A Tamil guy over in Regent Park had bitten off part of his wife's ear. When they got there, the wife claimed she'd fallen on a piece of glass. The coach house of a gay couple in Cabbage Town had been broken into, and the intruder had left a turd on their Persian rug. On Jarvis Street, an underage prostitute claimed she'd been punched in the face by the old wino who gave her a room in exchange for a nightly blowjob. Then she propositioned Kennicott. Run-of-the-mill stuff. By the 10th floor, he was breathing hard. It had been 3.5 years since he joined the force, turning his back on a promising career as a young lawyer at one of the city's top firms. The reason? His older brother, Michael, had been murdered 12 months before. When the investigation seemed to be going nowhere, he traded in his legal robes for a badge. This was exactly what he wanted. The chance to work on a homicide, he thought, as he started to take the stairs three at a time and clicked on his radio. Kennicott here, he said to Baring. I'm approaching the 11th floor. 10-4, forensics, homicide, and lots of cars are on the way. I've disabled the elevators. No one's come down the stairs. Turn off the radio. That way you can make a silent entry. 10-4, over and out. Kennicott burst through the door on the 12th floor and stopped. A long hallway ran straight ahead before it turned, presumably, to the elevator and the other half of the floor. Pale white wall sconces cast a gauze-like light into muted yellow walls. There was only one apartment in this section of the hall. Kennicott moved cautiously down to 12A. The door was halfway open. Taking a deep breath, he pushed it all the way to the wall as he unholstered his gun. Stepping forward, he found himself in a long, wide hallway that had a light-stained hardwood floor. Everything was quiet. It felt strange to barge into this calm, well-appointed suite, his gun out as if he were a little boy, playing cops and robbers in his backyard. "Toronto Police," he said in a loud voice. We are presently seated in the breakfast room, located at the rear of the flat, an East Indian-sounding male voice called out. The deceased lady is in the hall bathroom. He checked behind the front door and then walked slowly down the hallway, his boots thumping on the wood floor. Midway down, a door to his right was slightly ajar. The light was on, and he could see a sliver of white tiles. He didn't have gloves on, so he elbowed the door open. It was a small bathroom, and the door opened to the wall. He took two steps in. A raven-haired woman lay in the tub. Her eyes were wide open. Her face was drained of all blood, making it almost as white as the tub. There was no movement. He backed out of the room, careful not to touch anything. The sweat on his body felt sticky. "You will find us here," the East Indian voice said again. A few more steps down the hall, and Kennicott came to a big eat-in kitchen. To his right was Kevin Brace, the famous radio host, sitting quietly in a wrought iron chair. He was holding out a ceramic mug. He wore tattered slippers, and his frayed bathrobe was pulled up tight around his neck. His scruffy beard and his trademark old-fashioned, large, wire-rimmed glasses made him instantly recognizable. Brace didn't even look up. Across the table from Brace, an elderly brown-skinned man in a suit and tie was leaning over and pouring tea into Brace's mug. Between the two men, a gaudy Tiffany lamp hovered over the table like a large bubble in a cartoon in which dialogue was waiting to be written. Under the lamp's glow was a mostly eaten plate of sliced oranges. Kennicott could see that they were red. Blood oranges, he thought. On the far wall, floor-to-ceiling, south-facing windows looked over Lake Ontario, which stretched out like an enormous black pool. Barely illuminated by the hint of early morning light was the chain of small islands that formed a half-moon arc across the bay. Kennicott stopped momentarily, disoriented by the expansive view and the calm tableau in front of him. With his gun still out, he stepped onto the slick tile kitchen floor. Suddenly, his right foot slid out from under him. He jammed his arm down to break his fall, and the gun skittered out of his hand and slid halfway across the floor. What a rookie move, Kennicott thought as he pulled himself up. Great. The detective who gets this case will love this. Over at the table, Brace was pouring honey into his mug and stirring his tea as if nothing had happened. Kennicott edged toward his gun, careful not to slip again. "Kevin Brace?" he asked. Brace avoided Kennicott's eyes. His glasses were smudged. He didn't say anything, just concentrated on stirring his tea like a Swiss watchmaker at his workbench. Kennicott picked up his gun. "Mr. Brace, I am Officer Daniel Kennicott of the Toronto Police. Is the woman in the bathtub your wife?" "She certainly is," the East Indian man said, "and she is most assuredly dead. I saw much death in my years as a chief engineer for Indian Railways, which is the largest transportation company in the world." Kennicott looked over at the man. "I see, Mr.—" The elderly man jumped to his feet so quickly that Kennicott took a step back. "Gordial Singh," he said. "I am Mr. Brace's morning newspaper delivery person. I contacted the police service." "Morning newspaper delivery person, police service," Kennicott thought. The phrases sounded so odd he had to stop himself from smiling. He reached for his hand radio. "I arrived a minute earlier than my usual time at 5:29 and called at 5:31, once I had confirmed the fatality," Mr. Singh said. "Mr. Kevin and I have been having our tea awaiting your arrival. This is our second pot. It is a special Darjeeling I bring the first of each month, most effective for constipation." Kennicott looked at Brace. He was studying his spoon as if it were a priceless antique. Sliding the gun into its holster, Kennicott took a step back toward the table. He touched Brace lightly on the shoulder. "Mr. Brace, you are under arrest for murder," he said. He advised Brace of his right to counsel. Brace didn't change his gaze. He just flicked his free hand toward Kennicott, like a magician pulling something out of his sleeve. There was a business card between his bloodied fingers. Nancy Parrish, barrister and solicitor, practice restricted to criminal law. Kennicott clicked on his radio.
Kennicott here.
What's your location? Baring asked.
I'm in the condo.
Kennicott kept his voice low. The suspect's here with the witness, Mr. Gurdial Singh, the newspaper delivery person. The scene is calm. The victim is in the hall bathtub, appears DOA. I've made an arrest. Reporting that a victim appeared to be deceased, dead on arrival, was the top priority.
What's he doing?
Kennicott looked at Brace. The gray-haired broadcaster was pouring milk into his tea.
Drinking tea, he said.
Okay, just watch him. Backup is on the way. 10-4. And Kennicott, record every word he says.
Got it, over and out.
Kennicott put the radio into its hip holder and he could feel the adrenaline in his system begin to slow down. What would happen next? He studied Brace. Now his spoon was on the table, and he was sipping his Darjeeling tea, looking placidly out the window. Kennicott knew that a case like this could go in all sorts of unexpected directions, but as he looked at the little tea party in the kitchen, there was no doubt in his mind that Kevin Brace wasn't going to say a word. Chapter 3.
Damn it, stop yawning,
Detective Ari Green muttered to himself as he parked his 1988 Oldsmobile in the narrow driveway of his father's split-level bungalow and grabbed a paper bag from the passenger seat.
Good,
he thought, as he felt around inside it. The bagels from Greif's are still warm. He reached inside a second bag and extracted a carton of milk. He fished under his seat until he found a stash of plastic shopping bags and yanked out one from the Sobeys grocery store. This will work, Green thought as he plopped the milk into the bag. If his father discovered that the milk came from the bagel store, there'd be hell to pay.
You bought the milk at Greif's? How much? $2.99? This week at Sobeys, milk is $2.49 and $2.51 at Loblaws. I have a coupon for an extra 10 cents.
The words would tumble out in his dad's unique mixture of English and Yiddish. Green was coming off his 10th straight night shift. He'd been too tired to make a second trip to the grocery store. His father had been through enough in his life. The last thing he needed was to find out that his only surviving son was a lousy shopper. A thin layer of snow had fallen overnight. Green took the shovel from the metal railing and carefully cleared the concrete steps. He picked up the copy of the Toronto Star from in front of the door and stuck his key to his father's house into the lock. Inside, he heard the hum of the television set coming from the living room. He sighed. Since his mother died, his father hated to sleep in their bedroom. Instead, he'd watch TV in the den until he fell asleep on the plastic-covered couch. Green kicked off his shoes. He stacked the bagels on the counter, put the milk in the fridge, making sure to leave out the Sobeys bag, and walked noiselessly into the living room. His father was curled up under a tattered brown and white afghan Green's mother had knitted for his 70th birthday. His head had slipped off a small pillow and was hard against the thick plastic. Moving aside the teak coffee table in front of the sofa, Green knelt beside his sleeping father. As a homicide detective for the past 5 years and a cop for 20, he'd seen some pretty tough characters. None of them could hold a candle to this little Polish Jew who, try as they might, the Nazis couldn't kill. It's me, Dad. Ari, I'm home. Green touched his father's shoulder softly, then quickly moved back. He braced himself. Nothing happened. Still keeping his distance, he squeezed harder on his father's shoulder. He continued. Dad, I've picked up some warm bagels and milk. I'll get some denture cream for you tomorrow. His father's eyes flew open. This was the moment Green had dreaded every morning since he was a boy. What nightmare was Dad waking from? His father's gray-green eyes looked disoriented. "That, the bagels, are warm, and the milk." His father looked at his hands. Green moved closer again and slid the fallen pillow under his father's head. With his right hand, he caressed his face. His father mumbled, "Mein Tochter." It meant, "my daughter." Then he said her name, Hannah, the daughter he'd lost at Treblinka. Green lifted him into an upright position on the couch. His father seemed to gather strength, like a blow-up doll slowly being inflated. "Where did you buy the milk?" his dad asked.
"Sobeys."
"They have any coupons?" "They're out. You know what it's like at Christmas time." His father rubbed his face with his hands. "Yes, I know, Christmas time. You do extra shifts to help out your friends. You look tired. You worked last night." "For a few hours," Green lied. He was pretty sure his father knew it wasn't true. "Today you off?" Green touched the beeper on his hip. "Number one in the batting order." The batting order was the on-call list in the Homicide Bureau. "Maybe I'll get lucky and it'll be a peaceful day." His father patted him on the shoulder and felt the fabric of Green's lapel. "That fancy tailor of yours, his stitching is improving." In his heart, Green's father was still a tailor, the job he'd had as a young married man in his little Polish village until the morning in September 1942 when the Nazis surrounded it. In the line at Treblinka, a friend told the Ukrainian guard he was a cobbler. So that's what he became. When he came to Canada, he opened his own shoe shop in a downtown neighborhood that was a smorgasbord of European ethnic groups. It turned out that the Nazis had given him the perfect training ground. 2 years of mending shoes of Jews from all over Europe meant that he recognized almost every shoe that came in. "The stitching should be good," Green said, unbuttoning the jacket and showing his father the inside. "It took him 2 months to make it."
"2 months," his father snorted. "Sit down. I'll make myself some coffee. You want some tea?"
Green smiled. "No, I'm fine, Dad." The only place to sit was the plastic-covered couch. He'd hated the thing ever since he was old enough to have friends over to the house, rich kids whose parents didn't have accents, whose parents knew how to ski and play tennis, whose parents didn't have numbers on their arms. All these years later, he'd still loved to burn the darn sofa. But there was no point arguing with his father. Never was. And Green was dog-tired. He lay down and pulled the coffee table back into position so he could put his feet up on it.
"Leafs lose again," his father called from the kitchen. "I fell asleep at the end of the second period. It was 2-0 for Detroit."
"You'll be amazed," Green said. "They scored 3 goals in the last 10 minutes, beat the Wings 3-2.
"Unbelievable," his father said. "Maybe one game they won. Still they are terrible."
Green maneuvered his back, trying to get comfortable. He grimaced as he heard the plastic crack and squeak under his weight. As the only Jewish guy in Homicide, he'd scored lots of points by taking shifts this time of year. He didn't mind. For a rising star on the squad with just one unsolved case, this time of year was a bonanza. The last 3 Decembers, he'd had 3 homicides, but this year had been quiet. The smell of instant coffee wafted into the living room. It was a smell Green had disliked since he was a child. He shifted a bit on the couch. The beeper attached to the back of his belt was caught on the plastic.
"Dad, try the cream cheese I got for you on Friday." "I'm looking for it. Maybe I didn't wrap it right. After 3 days, it's stale," his father called from the kitchen. "You want some raspberry jam?"
"Sure, Dad," Green said. His eyelids felt heavy. As much as he despised the sofa, right now it felt comfortable. He reached back, unclipped the pager from his belt, and held it. That felt better. He was so tired his eyes began to shut. Suddenly, he sat bolt upright, crinkling the hard plastic underneath him, and squeezed the pager. It was buzzing wildly. Chapter 4
Alimony. All the money. All from Awotwe. All my money. That's it. All my money.
Awotwe Amunkwa thought as he doodled letters onto the back of his green reporter's pad.
Thanks to you, Madam Honorable Justice Heather Hillgate, you and your final divorce decree, I get access to Fatima and Abdul Wednesdays from 5:30 to 9, and Saturday afternoons from 2 to 5. One phone call per night between 7:30 and 8, that's it. The price of admission, $800 a month in support payments.
If you want your children overnight, get a place of your own, Justice Heather the Leather, as he liked to think of her, had lectured him the last time they were in court. Claire was there, dressed all prim and proper, like the wife on the Bill Cosby show, backed up by her high-priced lawyers, who filed motions against him quicker than his ex changed lovers. Amunkwa couldn't afford his lawyers anymore, so he was unrepresented. His next move to get the kids overnight was going to take months and money he didn't have to go back to court yet again. To keep up with the court order, Amunkwa had to do this graveyard shift in the radio room at the Toronto Star, the country's largest paper, where he'd worked for almost a decade. The radio room, also known as the box, the rubber room, and the panic room, was parked at the north end of the Star's enormous newsroom. It wasn't really a room, but a small glassed-in booth filled with a staggering array of equipment. There were 5 scanners, but only 2 worked, police and ambulance. They were on constantly, as was the 24-hour TV news station that in the middle of the night went to mind-dulling infomercials about exercise or kitchen equipment. The 24-hour radio news station ran at low level to complete the constant cacophony of sound. He had to check all of them, plus 2 different news services rolling through the fat old computer screen in the corner. And there was a long list of calls to be made hourly, police headquarters not just in Toronto, but in the far-reaching suburbs and surrounding cities, Durham, Peel, Halton, Milton, York, Oakville, Aurora, Burlington. This whole area was known as the Golden Horseshoe, the 5th biggest urban center in North America, so there was a lot of ground to cover. All the fire, transit, ambulance, and hospital authorities also had to be contacted, as well as the Ontario Provincial Police and, never forget, the lottery people. When things slowed down, you were expected to read through the daily paid obituaries to see if a story lurked there. At first it might look confusing, but the job was strictly entry-level, intern journalism student stuff, not something a veteran reporter like Amunkwa should be doing. He kept his BlackBerry on at all times to get emails from reporters in the field and in case something happened with his kids. Out through the front window, looking over the sprawling, near-empty newsroom, a row of clocks on the far wall displayed the current time in major cities around the world. Paris, Moscow, Hong Kong, Tokyo, Melbourne, Los Angeles. Amunkwa looked at them with the dreamy eyes of a poor child watching a limousine drive past. He'd wanted to be a foreign correspondent, the first black reporter at the Star to be sent overseas. But now that dream was in tatters. He looked at the clock labeled local time. It was 5:28. Another half hour to go. Then he'd have 4 hours to get back to his sister's apartment in Thorncliffe, where he was living on a couch, grab a shower, and be here for his regular 10 o'clock shift. He turned his gaze to the window in front of him. It was plastered with aged instructional memos, funny news clippings, and multicolored sticky notes. The protocol was for reporters to write out humorous things they heard on the scanners in the middle of the night and post them on the window. Amunkwa looked at some of the funny ones. December 29th, 2:12 a.m. Dispatcher. Did you say baklava? Cop 21 Division. Oh, it's been a long shift. He was wearing a balaclava. Cop 43 Division.
I'm not up on all the gangs in Scarborough, but I'm pretty sure there isn't one called the Nipples. Dispatcher. Regardless, they should be photographed anyway.
The radio room was warm. Amankwa had his jacket off and his tie loosened. Every 15 minutes, he made a detailed notebook entry in his neat script. This might be a lousy job, but he was still a good reporter. He did the work well. It had been a quiet night. The days before Christmas were a dead zone for news stories, and earlier in the night the desk had been hounding him to find something local for the front page. Amankwa had no good news to offer. Out in the suburbs there was an Iranian cab driver, a former history professor, who got robbed at knife point by a couple of young Asians. The kids weren't too bright. A bit of snow had fallen in the suburbs last night, and the cops followed the tracks in the snow back to one of their houses. And a group of Pakistani college students downtown brought some cricket bats into a donut shop and took some wax at one of their former friends. A drunk driver in the entertainment district ran over a cop's foot. Typical stuff, none of it front-page material. At about 1 in the morning, it had looked like he had some action. A rich doctor in Forest Hill caught his wife in bed with his teenage son's best friend. He'd sliced the kid with a kitchen knife. At first, it sounded as if he'd cut the young stud's cock off. Amankwa called the desk and they got all excited. They were hoping the doctor was a surgeon, but an hour later, it turned out the guy was just a dermatologist and he'd used a butter knife. All the teenager had was a scrape on the back of his hand. A bloody butter knife, Amankwa thought. What a wimp. He checked the wall clock for Toronto, 5:30. He checked the wire services for fresh news alerts. Nothing. He listened to the half-hour report on the all-news radio station. Not a thing. He turned on the cabbie dispatchers and listened for a full minute. Nada. Finally, he checked the police scanner. There was the usual chatter. Then he heard code red. He turned up the dial. The cops changed their codes every week, but it wasn't exactly hard to figure out that code red meant something urgent, probably homicide. He heard the address, the Marketplace Tower, number 85A, Front Street, Suite 12A. Amankwa's body jerked. Holy shit. He'd been in that penthouse suite. It was the home of Kevin Brace, the famous radio host. A few years before, Amankwa and Claire were on his show and they'd been invited to the Christmas party Brace and his younger second wife hosted every year in early December. Back when Amankwa and Claire were the city's glamour couple, smart, black, and beautiful. Back when Amankwa, a hot young reporter on the city beat, was the token black face in all the newspaper promo ads. Amankwa bit his lip. Brace's building was a few blocks away. He turned down the volume on the scanner and moved his ear closer to the speaker. He could pick up the cops on the street. They were smart enough to keep Brace's name off the airways. Imagine, Kevin Brace, Mr. All-Canadian Good Guy, according to his adoring fans. The Voice of Canada, they called him. Recent J-school grads in the radio rooms of the other three newspapers in town wouldn't pick this up. Red-hot news, maybe even a murder in Kevin Brace's condo, was flying under the radar, and he was the only one who had it. Amankwa looked out at the near-deserted newsroom. There was only one editor manning the website, and another babysitting some copy. He needed to alert them right away. But he knew what would happen once they got hold of this. They'd hand the story to one of the overnight writers who were on call. If Amankwa was lucky, all he'd get would be a nice little pat on the back, and then he'd be forgotten. He started to pace. Any minute now, an urgent alert would flash on the wires, and the news would be everywhere. Keep calm, he thought, as he eased his wallet out of his jacket and slipped it into his back pocket. He palmed his digital camera, which was crammed with pictures of his children, and squeezed it in his hand. Trying to look casual, he walked out of the airless room and gave an exaggerated yawn. "Just going down to grab a coffee," he said, as he sauntered past the editor closest to him, jiggling some coins in his pocket with his free hand. The night cleaner, a large Portuguese woman, was at the bank of elevators outside the newsroom. Amankwa pushed the down button and leaned against the wall, stifling another yawn. The cafeteria was one floor below. The up button was already lit. The up elevator opened with a loud ding, and the cleaner got in. Amankwa affected a look of utter disinterest. The moment the doors closed, he ran for the stairway against the glassed-in west wall. Watching the dark street, he flew down the concrete stairs two steps at a time, his footsteps echoing. Five floors down, he hit the ground and walked casually out the fire door. He waved to the man at the security desk and opened the front door onto Young Street. Then he raced north, bracing himself against the wind. He had to pass through a tunnel under the Gardiner Expressway, the ugly highway built in the 1950s that cut the city off from the lake. Clearly, back then, planners forgot that people knew how to walk. As a meager concession to pedestrian traffic, on the side of the road there was a thin sidewalk hemmed in by a concrete railing. Every morning it was packed with people rushing to work, many of them residents of the islands south of the city who regularly commuted by ferry. A few hours later, and he'd have been stuck. Running now at full speed, squeezing the camera in his hand like a sprinter with a baton, he rushed out of the north side of the tunnel, got to Front Street, and cut east. He was breathing hard. The cold wind ripped down the back of his shirt. Just one block to go. He could see the sign for the marketplace tower. "I need this story, I need this story, I need this story," he chanted to himself, like the old train in the little engine that could, the book he used to love to read every night to the kids. "I need this story, I need this story. I need this story." Chapter 5. The early morning streets were empty, and Detective Irie Green was making great time. It always amazed him how quickly he could zip through the city when there was no traffic, and he'd put his magnetic police flasher on the roof of his car, giving him carte blanche to run every red light. One more hour and the roads would be clogged with commuters. He got to Front Street, turned east, and drove quickly past some of the city's oldest red brick buildings, 4 and 5 stories high, most lovingly restored. Storefronts with large, tasteful windows looked out onto unusually wide sidewalks on both sides of the street, giving Front a comfortable, almost European feel. The marketplace tower stood tall at the end of a long, elegant block. Green turned south at the corner and found a parking spot on the side street behind an old truck that still had snow on its back cab. Must be a supplier coming down to the St. Lawrence Market across the street. On winter mornings, when the snow had melted on the city streets, commuters from the colder outlying suburbs and towns carried the white stuff in with them. Green got out of his car and headed quickly toward the condo. He passed a driveway on the side street, where a discreet sign read, "Parking for exclusive use of marketplace residents. Visitors please sign in with the concierge." He kept on walking very fast, not running. There were certain unwritten protocols about being a homicide detective. You dressed well, you didn't carry a gun, and most of all, unless it was a true emergency, you never ran. The automatic double doors of the condo slid open. Behind a long rosewood desk, a Middle Eastern-looking man in a uniform was reading the Toronto Sun. "Detective Green, Toronto Police Homicide," he said. "Good morning, Detective." Rashid was sewn on his jacket above his left breast, and he spoke with a lilting accent. Probably had a PhD in physics back home, Green thought. Up ahead, a uniformed female police officer stood perfectly positioned near a bank of 2 elevators and a doorway, which Green assumed led to the stairs. Sensing his presence, she turned her head. Green saw who it was and grinned. Officer Nora Baring nodded, gave the elevators one last look, and walked toward him, meeting him halfway. "Hello, Detective," Baring said, shaking his hand. She was all business. "I've disabled the elevators, except for police use. My partner took the stairs up to the 12th floor. He radioed in from the apartment, and the scene is secure. Ambulance is on scene. Victim appears DOA. Two sets of officers from the division have already taken the suspect and the witness to headquarters. Detective Ho, the forensic officer, is on his way up. My partner's on scene, maintaining continuity. Green nodded. Baring was one of the best street cops on the force. Who's your partner? He asked. Anyone who worked with Baring would be well trained. Baring hesitated for a moment. Officer Daniel Kennicott, she said. Green nodded his head slowly. He could feel Baring's eyes on him. Kennicott's brother was murdered 4.5 years ago, and Green was the detective on the case, his only unsolved file. A year after the murder, when Kennicott quit his law practice to become a cop, the story of a hotshot young lawyer who turned his back on the towers of Bay Street proved irresistible to the press. It didn't hurt that Kennicott was handsome, single, and articulate, and clearly he didn't want all the attention which seemed to make the story all the more compelling. Green had treated Kennicott like any other victim who'd had a family member murdered. After their initial flurry of meetings, things had fallen into a pattern. Every 2 months they got together for a case update. When Kennicott joined the force, the meetings always took place when he was off shift, out of uniform. To his credit, Kennicott never asked for special consideration. But over the years, as the meetings grew shorter, Kennicott's frustration became palpable. There's an inevitable tension between a homicide detective and a victim's family. Their expectations, wanting a quick arrest, a speedy trial, a conviction, and a harsh sentence, often had to be tempered by the realities of police procedure and the legal system. The Crown attorneys intentionally stayed aloof, so as their primary contact, the victims turned to the detective, at times for comfort, at times to vent their frustration. Professionally, Green and Kennicott had avoided each other on duty. It was unspoken, but they both knew it was best. Perhaps it was time for that to change, Green thought. Secretly, he'd followed Kennicott's career like a hands-off older brother. He'd been impressed by the young man's progress. There was a saying on the force, to make it to homicide, you needed a rabbi, someone to watch over and promote your career. Kennicott's got everything under control, Baring said. Not surprised, Green said. He turned back to Rashid, the concierge. How many elevators are there to the 12th floor? The two you see in front of you, and a service elevator around back. Green leaned over the lobby desk and scanned a row of live television monitors. Do these cover all the exits? Yes, yes. Certainly the main doors. Something about the man's answer bothered him. Are there other doors? Rashid looked vaguely uncomfortable. Just one in the basement parking lot. There is no camera on that, but it is rarely used and it closes from the inside. Green looked back at Baring. I had all three elevators disabled, including the service, she said. I covered the stairs until backup arrived. There was no way to cover the basement. Right move, Green said. The calculation was easy. Baring was alone down here and had to watch for someone coming into or trying to leave the lobby, and Green knew Baring was smart enough not to lose sight of Rashid. How do you know if the basement door is opened? He asked the concierge. I check it when I do my rounds. Did you check it this morning? Not yet. The door's rarely used. This is a quiet building. It won't be quiet for much longer, Green thought, with Kevin Brace's wife lying dead in their bathtub. What if someone puts a brick in the door? Rashid blushed. It happens once in a while. Green nodded. That was the second time Rashid had been less than forthcoming in his answers. He walked to the elevator bank and went through a mental checklist. Baring had covered the lobby, the suspect and the witness were already taken away, and the forensic officer was now on scene. As much as he wanted to get upstairs, first he had to check the basement. There was a stairway beside the elevator, and as he reached for the door, it swung open. A rather short, older woman, her gray hair combed elegantly back up over her head, marched straight out. She wore a long black coat, and a blazing blue scarf was tied neatly around her neck. She strode toward the front door, her posture erect.
"Morning, Rashid,"
she said to the concierge, moving quickly. Green rushed up beside her just before she got to the outer door. A rolled-up mat was slung over her shoulder. She had two white towels under her arm and a big water bottle in her hand. "Excuse me, ma'am," he said, flashing his badge. "Detective Ari Green, Toronto Police. We've closed the building down for a few minutes." He didn't want to identify himself as a homicide detective.
"Closed? What do you mean, closed?"
The woman had a mild British accent, the kind that sounded as if it had been modified by many years in Canada. Up close, she had high cheekbones that were accentuated by her age. She wore no makeup. Her skin was still remarkably smooth. Something about the dignified way in which she carried herself made Green smile. "We're investigating an incident in the building," Green said. "What does that have to do with me?" the woman asked. "My class starts in 11 minutes. Green moved all the way in front of her, blocking her exit. "This is a serious matter, I'm afraid." She nodded toward the front desk. "Rashid can give you any information you need, I'm sure." Green opened a leather-bound maroon notebook and pulled out his initialed cross pen, the one that Chief Hap Charlton had given him when he made homicide. The woman moved slightly closer to him. Green could smell a hint of perfume that made him smile again. "Could I have your name, please?" he asked. "Edna Wingate. Will this take long? I hate to be tardy. My yoga instructor does not tolerate late arrivals." "You live in this building, Miss Wingate?" "Suite 12B. It's hot yoga, detective," she said, giving him a coquettish grin. "I always bring two towels." "And how long have you lived here?"
20 years.
"You should try hot yoga. Men like it." "We've disabled the elevators," Green said. "I apologize for forcing you to walk down the stairs." Wingate laughed, a light, engaging chuckle.
"I never take the elevator. 12 floors up and down. My yoga instructor says I have the strongest quads he's ever seen in an 83-year-old.
On his drive down, Green had called the dispatcher. He knew there were only 2 suites on the top floor.
"Notice anything unusual on the 12th floor last night or this morning?" he asked.
"Absolutely," she said, without missing a beat.
"And what was
my newspaper? I'm concerned about Mr. Singh. Never known him to miss a day."
"Anything else?"
"No. Please, I really must go."
"Can we make a deal?" he asked. "I'll unseal the building for you now so you can make your class if you'll let me drop by and ask some questions tomorrow morning."
She took a quick look at her watch. It was a swatch, quite stylish.
"You'll have to try some of my Christmas shortbread," she said, flashing him a charming smile, and that laugh again.
"Shall I come by before 6?
"Come at 8. Monday's my only early class." "Ta," she said, putting her hand on his shoulder as she waltzed past him, her posture still picture perfect.
He watched Wingate move swiftly to the sidewalk, cross the empty street, and disappear into the morning darkness. Green paused for a moment, taking in the last hint of her perfume, before he went upstairs to see the body of the dead woman in the bathtub.
Chapter 6.
6 o'clock. Perfect, Albert Fernandez thought, as he toweled his face dry and combed back his deep black hair. 10 minutes to shave, clip his nails, brush his teeth, and dry off, another 15 to get dressed, 10 if he hurried. By 6:30 the coffee machine would click on, and he'd be out the door by 6:50. Drive downtown in 30 minutes, and he'd beat the 7:30 deadline for early bird parking by at least 10 minutes. He wrapped a lush green towel around his waist and quietly made his way out of the ensuite bathroom. Marissa was asleep in their bed. He stopped. Her black hair was tousled on the white sheets, and he could see the curve of her back and shoulders. 2 years into their marriage, and it still amazed Fernandez that he got to sleep with this beautiful, naked woman night after night.
It had been worth it to bring a young bride back from Chile, he thought, despite his parents' objections. They'd wanted him to marry a Canadian from a good socialist background, like the people who'd taken them in as political refugees back in the 1970s. Instead, much to their consternation, he'd gone home and found a woman from one of the country's wealthiest families. His mother and father hadn't spoken to him since. Fernandez tossed the damp towel on a chair and entered his favorite room in the apartment, the clothes closet. He loved looking at his rack of finely tailored suits. My passports to success, he thought, fingering the gabardine sleeve of his dark blue jacket. He ran his hands over the row of shirts on hangers and picked out one of his best off-white Egyptian cotton with French cuffs. He held the shirt up to the light. He whispered to himself, shaking his head. Marissa had grown up with a house full of servants. Now she was learning to do the ironing. He would have to talk to her about the collars. He caressed his overburdened tie rack and settled on a deep red Armani tie. His fine clothes were an important part of Fernandez's personal business plan. He pinched pennies in every other part of his life so he could buy them. Most of the other prosecutors at the downtown Crown Law Office dressed like schoolteachers or salesmen with their crepe-soled shoes, brown suits, and muted ties. Not Albert. He always dressed impeccably, the way a real lawyer should. He selected his dark brown loafers and examined their shine. They needed buffing. That would cost him 2 or 3 minutes. Putting on his shirt, he did up his tie, then slipped on his pants and selected one of his favorite belts, burnished brown leather with a simple brushed metal buckle. When Fernandez was called to the bar, he had purchased a men's fashion encyclopedia and had counseled that a belt should be done up to the third notch. He pulled his belt on and tried to get it to the well-worn line after the third hole, but this morning it felt tight. It took him a moment to realize he had to suck in his stomach to do the belt up. Alarmed, he lifted his shirt and examined himself in the full-length mirror. Sure enough, his thin waistline had expanded. This was unbelievable. He'd always looked askance at the other male lawyers in his office, fat bellies overhanging their leatherette belts. That was it, he swore to himself. No more cheap sandwiches, no more eating donuts from the inevitable pack that got passed around the Crown's office at the end of the day. Finally dressed, he emerged into the half-light of the bedroom. The illuminated clock radio beside the bed read 6:18, 2 minutes ahead of schedule. Marissa had stirred in her sleep and rolled over. The sheet slid down, exposing the top part of her right breast. Fernandez tiptoed to the edge of the bed and bent to kiss her hair. His eyes drifted down toward the rise in the sheets. Even though he saw his wife naked all the time, he still found himself sneaking looks at her body at just about every opportunity. A warm hand touched his thigh. "You're not happy in my ironing?" Marissa said, her voice hoarse with sleep. His tisk-tisking must have been overheard. "With my ironing," he corrected her. "Yes, it needs work." Marissa's hand fell away from his leg. Damn it, he thought. He kept making the same mistake. Hidden in his closet, between two folded sweaters, was a book he read on Tuesday nights when Marissa went to her English as a second language classes. It was called Marriage Survival Guide: How to Get Past the First Years. One of the key things it said over and over again was don't be too critical. Support your spouse. "But I'm sure you will get better," he said, reaching for her arm. "I need to get the iron more hot, no?" she asked. Her hand came back up again and lightly caressed his pant leg. "Yes, hotter," he said. "It's difficult." Marissa's warm lips parted in a tentative smile. "And to press more hard?" she said. As she spoke, she began to rub her hand up then down his leg. "Harder. See how fast you are learning?" "Hotter and harder," she said as she pulled her other hand out from under the covers and began to rub his thigh. Despite himself, Fernandez lifted his eyes to the digital clock radio on the far side of the bed. The time was 6:26. Now he was a minute behind schedule. Without the early bird parking, it was another $4. Marissa wet her lips with her tongue. She rolled over toward him and put her hands on his belt buckle. I wonder if she noticed the extra notch, he thought, as she undid it. He took his eyes off the clock. You deserve this, Albert, he told himself. He was always the first lawyer in the office. So what if for one day he was the second or third? Marissa tugged at his pants. After all, he could skip lunch to make up the $4, and that way he'd lose a bit of weight. She reached for his hand and lay back, bringing it to the top of her chest. Her hardening nipple rose to the soft skin of his palm. She kept moving his hand lower as she elevated her hips to meet his fingers. His belt undone, his pants, and then his boxer shorts brought down below his knees, she reached around his back. For the last few months, Marissa had been complaining, "Albert, you leave too early every morning," she'd said, "and home so late." It's important, he'd explained to her, to get ahead in the Crown's office. I need to work harder than everyone else. But your wife needs you too, she'd insisted. She does need me, Fernandez thought as her lips parted and she took him in. Their bodies began to move in rhythm, her black hair waving on the white sheet. He could smell the sweetness of her. Close your eyes, he told himself, and enjoy the moment. It was 6:39 when he zipped up his pants, too late for sure for the early parking. In the kitchen, the preset coffee had been sitting for almost 10 minutes. It would be stale by now, but there wasn't time to make a fresh brew. He pulled out his old glass vacuum thermos and filled it. As bad as the coffee would taste, it would be miles better than the horrible stuff at the Crown's office. At the front door of their apartment, he picked up the Toronto Star. He scanned the paper for the only news he really cared about. Had there been a murder last night? A picture of Toronto hockey players raising their sticks in victory dominated the front page, and a quick flip through confirmed the bad news. No one in the whole city had been killed. It had been 4 weeks without a murder. What a time for a dry spell, Fernandez thought as he slammed the newspaper down. For the last 5 years, he had worked his way up the ladder at the Crown's office. His plan had been deliberate. Arrive first, leave last, every day. Always be perfectly prepared and well-dressed. Get to know the judges. Secreted in a bottom drawer of his desk was a set of index cards with the peculiarities and preferences of each judge carefully noted in his fine handwriting. And win cases. His hard work had paid off. A month ago, the head crown, Jennifer Raglan, called him into her corner office. Albert, she said, shifting a large stack of files off her ever-crowded desk, I know you're itching to prosecute a homicide. I'm happy to take whatever comes my way, he said. Raglan smiled. You've earned a shot. Pretty impressive for someone just 5 years out. Next murder has your name on it. Now, down in the basement garage, as he waited for his old Toyota to warm up, he slid his black leather driving gloves out from their special compartment. Just before he left the bed, Marissa had whispered to him in English, That was second base. Tonight, we will make home run. We will hit a home run, he'd whispered back. Hit home run, but make love? That's right. Your English is so strange. It'll be worth running home tonight, Fernandez thought as he pulled on the gloves and slammed the car into gear. Now all I need is an overnight murder, and except for that overbrewed coffee, this will be a perfect morning. Chapter 7 They sure as fuck never taught this in law school, Nancy Parrish thought as she struggled to pull on her second pair of pantyhose of the morning, having ripped to shreds the first one just minutes before. Opening the door of the nearby closet, she couldn't help but catch herself in the full-length mirror, the only one in her tiny, semi-detached home. Now there's a lovely sight first thing in the morning, she thought, a single woman pushing 40 in nothing but pantyhose.
Parrish looked over at her ancient answering machine. Every night she had the calls from her office forwarded to her home number. When she was a keen, young defense lawyer, she'd answered calls in the middle of the night, but a few years earlier she had started turning the volume off before she went to sleep. The message waiting light flashed 7. 7 bloody calls, and I haven't even had a cup of coffee. You jerk, Henry, she thought. This is all your fault. Last month, her ex-husband, a show producer at the Dawn Treader, Kevin Brace's popular morning radio program, had talked her into coming on as a guest on a panel called Single Professional Women, Are They Happy? Only me, she thought. What an idiot. Let your ex get you to babble to the whole country about how you're eating scrambled eggs alone for dinner on Saturday nights. Henry had warned her to watch what she said, but did she listen? She completely forgot that more than 1 million people were out there, and Brace was so damn charming. Finally, after the scrambled eggs, she'd blurted out, "Men are afraid to have sex with a woman who earns more money than they do." That was it. For days, her answering machine had been filled with calls from guys from all over Canada and the northern United States, saying they were prepared to overcome their fears. Even a few women had called. Unbelievable. Parrish looked at the floor where she'd tossed her new leather boots last night before she'd crawled into bed. Damn it, she thought. A thin white line of road salt had formed a ring about 2 inches above the heel. She shook her head. Last September, she had finally gone to the trouble of buying boots early in the season, and she'd paid full price because this winter she wanted a pair that looked good. The voice of the persnickety shoe salesman who'd sold her the darn things and then sold her all the overpriced leather conditioners rang in her ears. "Spray them tonight when you get home with this," he'd said, lifting a small can that cost $19.99. "Wait 24 hours and do it again, then coat them with this." He held up a bottle with some brown liquid gunk in it. That cost only $12.99. "Use this once a week." "Wait 24 hours, then once a week," Paris said, pointing to the 2 jars, while she added the tax in her head. Neat, she thought. This is my ritual initiation into a secret society of people who actually know how to take care of their winter boots. Slobs, the salt-free, leather-only boots sisterhood. And every night, wipe them down with a cloth dipped in plain vinegar, the salesman said. No water. Water just pushes the salt farther into the leather. No water, she promised. Shoe trees are vital. Put them in within 5 minutes of taking the boots off while they're still warm. 5 minutes, she pledged. The shoe trees cost another $33, not including tax. What a waste of money, she'd thought a month later. The weather in October and November had been warm, and she forgot about them. Then there was a cold snap and sudden snowfall at the beginning of December. By that time, she couldn't remember where she'd put the stupid spray and leather conditioner, and when she finally found them, she couldn't remember which one was the 24-hour and which one was the weekly thing. Looks like my membership in Slobs has expired, Parrish thought, as she tossed the boots back on the floor, making yet another mental note to remember to buy plain vinegar next time she went shopping. The only vinegar she had in the house was balsamic. That would make a good cartoon, she thought, wondering where she'd left her sketchbook. A well-dressed couple are searching through the cupboards of their modern kitchen. "Darn it, Gwyneth," the man is saying to his wife, "the kids have got into the balsamic. Again." With her bare elbow, she hit the play button, and the first message came on. Beep. "Hello, Ms. Parrish. You don't know me, but I'm looking for a lawyer for my son. We don't have any money, but I heard you were good and that you take legal aid." She smacked the skip button with her fist and stared at herself in the mirror. Her hair was still wet from the shower, so she started to towel it dry while she wrote up a mental report card of her naked self. Hair, one of her best features, still thick and bouncy, down to her shoulders. She could get away with the length, but for how much longer? Last winter, a drunk guy at an après ski party in Whistler told her she had great, give-me-a-blowjob hair. Right.
That trip cost more than $2,000, and she never even got kissed. Next message. Beep. Hi, Nancy. It's James again. You were right. I should have stayed away from Lucy, but, well, you know, I'm at 55 division. No more Form 10s. They're holding me this time. I'll be in 101 bail court this morning at the hall. She hit the skip button. Face. She'd always been attractive, but rarely beautiful. Her skin was good, but it didn't gleam the way it used to. Back when she and Henry were living the young couple high life, one night at the symphony opening night ball, an older man asked her to dance. "You have such wonderful skin," he said. "You won't need to wear makeup until you're in your 40s. She was turning 38 next month, and she rarely ventured out without at least some blush on. Next message. Beep. Nancy Gale, your father and I are going to be downtown on Wednesday night for the ballet, and, well, I know it's corny as heck, but we were wondering if you would like to come with us and look at the Christmas windows at the bay. Skip. Neck and shoulders. Her best feature. Guys are idiots, so obsessed with tits and asses. But think Audrey Hepburn, think Grace Kelly, those long necks that go on forever, those shoulders that could cut glass. Beep. Miss Parrish, this is Brenda Crawford from the Law Society of Upper Canada. We're still awaiting your response from our request for your updated accounting ledger. As you know, if you do not respond within... Fuck, she said, and smacked the skip button with her fist. Breasts? Not bad still, she thought, raising her arms in the air, especially if you squint your eyes a bit. Nose. She hated noses. Take any woman in the world, say Julia Roberts. Beautiful, right? Now look at her nose. Stare at it. In a few seconds, her whole face turns ugly. Beep.
Hi, it's me. What about the Dominican?
Zelda. Parrish muttered to herself, shaking her head. Zelda Evinrude, her best friend, was on a mission to improve Parrish's sex life. Expedia's got a special deal if we leave before Christmas. Beats going home and being bored at your parents' place.
Those Dominican boy toys look awful cute.
Beep. Parrish took a step closer to the mirror. From there, you could see her nose had a small bump right in the middle.
Beep. You don't know me, but I heard you on the radio the other... No more, she screamed.
There was just one call left.
Beep.
Miss Parrish, it's Detective Ari Green, Homicide Squad. The time
now is... We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.